Well, good morning, Grace Church. It's amazing to see you. Hey, we're going to do something a little different today. You know, corporate worship through song has been a huge part of the weekly gathering throughout church history. Now, Christ, of course, is what makes anything in a worship service special, but he uses music to embed his truth in our hearts and minds for times when we are full of fear or full of joy, right? As Christians living now, not only do we have timeless truth from God's word being written in new songs all the time today, we also have access to a vast and rich tapestry of songs from the past. Songs from like not that long ago even, like the last 20 or 30 years. For some of you, that's a long time ago, maybe before you were born, but for some of us, that wasn't that long ago, right? And that maybe when we were first saved or first being like raised up in the Lord. If you've been a part of our church for a while, you know as a worship pastor that I have absolutely no shame in doing a throwback. I love them, hymns and early modern worship songs. And sometimes it can be like revisiting like a meal from growing up that your grandma used to make, you know? It does something for the soul. A few weeks ago, we sang Shout to the Lord together. And a beautiful song, right? So it brought so many of us back. So I thought for this morning, why not do a whole Sunday full of 90s and 2000s throwback worship songs? Right? Now, some of these songs maybe you've never heard. Maybe you've just become a Christian recently, or they're a little too old for you. Either way, the songs that we normally sing in church, those will be these songs for you. But I still believe you'll be blessed today. And for others, it might take a little dusting off, but I think you'll remember. And maybe they'll be used by God to remind you of the joy of your salvation and help bring you back to your first love, like we talked about last week. Are you guys ready to sing to the God of the universe this morning? Yeah. All right, let's sing.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember, so remember your people.
Says, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Amen.
To me.
Together, Father, that is what we pray this morning. That, Lord, your presence would be what we desire, and that's what we would seek. And that we know that we could have all the riches of the world. We could be given the things that Satan tempted Jesus with in the wilderness, yet none of that would compare to an eternal relationship with you. You are holy, perfect, high, and lifted up. So we acknowledge that this morning in our singing, in our worship, and in our hearts. We trust you. Thank you for the gift of salvation. It's in Jesus' precious, holy, perfect name we pray this morning. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. Well, thank you for joining us here at EP, the chapel, and Chaska, and online. We are in a lengthy teaching series, new teaching series, walking through the most mysterious, misunderstood, and misinterpreted book in the Bible, the book of Revelation, and you've jumped in at a really great time. Last weekend, we started digging into the seven churches of Revelation for chapters 2 and 3, and someone asked me, like, well, why seven? Like, we know there were more than seven churches in Asia Minor, right? We know there was Colossae, Lystra, Derbe, and Miletus, just to name a few. So like, why the number seven? Good question. Well, the answer is that for John and people in the ancient world, seven is the number of divine completeness. And so seven churches is a way of just saying or communicating the complete church. Not the perfect church, but the complete church. And so the seven churches then represent and embody every major issue that the church, the universal church, has struggled with in every age and in every cultural setting. And yes, you need to understand that these seven churches are actual, real, historical congregations, right? Smyrna, by the way, still exists today. It bears the name Izmir, which is the third largest city in Turkey. So let's stand together, read together in your Bible, on your Bible app, Revelation 2, beginning in verse 8. We'll get to work here. John writes, "Unto the angel of the church in Smyrna, write the words of the first and the last who died and came to life. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you're rich. And the slander of those who say that they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you're about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested. And for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. You'll notice here that when Jesus presents himself there in verse 8 as the first and the last who died and came to life, he's actually echoing Isaiah's prophecies about himself in chapters 41, 44, and 48. And so Jesus wants the disciples in Smyrna, and he wants us to know that our lives are bracketed by, boundaried by, protected by the person of Jesus Christ. So not by the decisions or the actions of Caesar, not by the rise and fall of Rome, not by any political or governmental leader or policy or authority, not by the ebb and flow of all things morally and spiritually in the United States. Our lives are bracketed by, boundaried by, protected by Christ, who is the first and the last, which means that no king is in control of our lives, no empire is in control of our futures, no government is in control of our lives, as much as our government is trying to control things. No culture, right? No culture is in control of our lives. Jesus Christ himself, and Jesus Christ alone, has bracketed our lives, boundaried our lives from beginning to end. And so our lives are like wrapped up in his life. He was before us, he's with us now, and he will be with us tomorrow. And all God's people said, ah, yeah, ah, feels good, right? Moreover, verse 8 also signaled to the church at Smyrna that Jesus knew exactly what was going on in their city and in their church. You see, Smyrna rivaled Ephesus as kind of the first city of Asia, really prominent city there in Asia Minor. So on their coins were stamped the words, "First City of Asia in size and beauty." And so this city loved the word first. Not only that, but Smyrna had gone through a number of dead but come back to life experiences themselves, right, as a community. It was actually destroyed in 580 BC, but rebuilt in 290 BC. And so the city of Smyrna was actually proud of their history and their heritage of death to life. That was a part of their national identity. That's why the words, "the first and the last who died and came to life," like touched down with them. It really resonated and connected with them and actually gave them tremendous hope, because they knew then that John had a word from God for them. Now, the reason they needed a word from God was because they were getting hammered. I mean, hammered, smashed for their faith in Jesus Christ. Well, how do we know? Well, when Jesus says in verse 9, "I know your tribulation," he's not talking about like the 7-year tribulation that is to come. He's talking about their own personal struggles and tribulations. And he uses the Greek word thlipsis, which literally means like a squeezing, crushing pressure. Thlipsis is the pressure experienced when two kingdoms clash. So it's when the kingdom of God clashes with the kingdom of man. It's where light clashes with darkness, where life clashes with death, where godly values clash against ungodly values. It's the pressure experienced where human pride is confronted with the call to repentance. There is this clashing, this pressure that is going on. And the church at Smyrna was in big time conflict, clashing with the culture and the governmental authorities around them. And this clashing was actually the reason they were experiencing poverty. One commentator said, I'll put it on the screens here. So he says, I know your tribulation and I know your poverty. Why were they in poverty? Well, Smyrna was a wealthy city. Like, no one in that city should have been poor. But the fact is, Christians were poor. They had not given in to the pressure to conform to the ways of the city. So in their businesses, they were choosing to do it Christ's way. As a result, those who resisted Jesus' way in both Roman and Jewish circles would not do business with Christians. They put the squeeze on them, right? So Christians were ostracized and boycotted. Their shops were confiscated and their homes ransacked. They were denied employment. So this was no joke. They were being attacked culturally. They were being attacked governmentally for their faith in Jesus Christ. And it was affecting life. It was affecting their livelihoods. It was affecting their way of living. And that's not all. There was also this tremendous hostility and backlash from a segment within the Jewish community. Here's a little of the backstory here. Under Roman law, the Jews were actually exempt from all sacrificial obligations and from military service, meaning they weren't obligated to worship Caesar by going to the temple, taking a pinch of incense, casting it on the altar and declaring that Caesar is God. And so the Jews, understandably, lived with a ton of stress and anxiety about their exemptions, right? Because those rights and privileges could be revoked at any time by the whim of the Senate. Therefore, when some of the Jews within the Jewish community actually became followers of Jesus Christ, they took, obviously, a bold stand against worshiping Caesar as God. They spoke out about it. They spoke against it, right? They declared that it was sinful to do so. It was wrong. It was offensive. It was idolatrous. And they stood out and they stood up against that practice in the Roman Empire. And so, fearful of losing their rights and privileges, many of them within the Jewish community decided, we're gonna kiss up to Rome by ratting out these new Christians who opposed the emperor's edict. And so this kind of explains Jesus' phrase here in verse 9. The slander of those who say that they're Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. So Jesus is referring then to the Jews who sold out the Christian community solely to appease the government in order to maintain all of their rights, their privileges, and their exemptions. Jesus then declared that they're no longer worthy of the title synagogue of the Lord, but rather they're actually the synagogue of Satan. They were aligning with Satan, not God, on this issue. And so you kind of take a step back, get your bearings here for a moment, and kind of pull it all together, and here's what you'll see. The Christians in Smyrna were being pressured and harassed and persecuted by culture, clashing with culture. The Christians in Smyrna were being pressured and harassed and persecuted by the governmental authorities, and they were being pressured and harassed and persecuted by some of their own countrymen. Like, this was not inconsequential. They were actually poorer for it. And they were in the crosshairs, right, of the culture and the government and even their own peers in society. And their faith in Jesus Christ cost them. It cost them status. It cost them prestige. It cost them cash. It cost them work. It cost them jobs. It cost them comfort. It cost them protection. So imagine how they felt then when they heard this word from Jesus. I know your tribulation. Like, I know your poverty. I know what you guys are going through. I know the slander of your people. So what does he say next? Well, I wish he would have said something like this. I know how hard this is. I know how unfair this is for you. Like, I know your pressure. I know what you're feeling. I know what you're going through. And now I'm going to lift it because my people should not have to face such danger and struggle and difficulty. Like, my people, when they follow me, you're going to be insulated against the pressure of a broken and godless world. That is what I wish he said, but that is not what he said. Look in verse 10. Instead, he says, do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil's about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested. And for 10 days, you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I'll give you the crown of life. How many of you hear that? You go, oh, not very encouraging here. Thank you for that. Not what any of us want to hear. Essentially, basically, Jesus tells them, it's going to get worse before it gets better. It's going to get worse before it gets better, but it's going to be worth it in the end. That's the only little nuance there. It's going to get worse before it gets better, but it's worth it. But it's worth it. And specifically, he says in verse 10, don't fear what you're about to suffer. The devil's going to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested. Now, you might be thinking, man, oh man, like, what did the Christians in Smyrna do wrong? Like, what were their issues? What were their struggles? Well, none. They didn't do anything wrong. Notice there's no word of criticism. There's no word of correction here. There's no call to repentance here. There's no call to take corrective action. Like, if you don't do this, I'll remove your lampstand or your impact or your effectiveness. Zero, none of that. Unlike Ephesus, who had lost her first love, unlike Laodicea, who had become lukewarm in her faith, the people of Smyrna had it going on, man. They were faithful to Jesus Christ. They were sold out for the kingdom of God, which tells us that as the church, as God's people, as Christ followers, we have to understand that whenever Christians are making an impact for Christ, making a dent in the darkness, the forces of darkness in our culture, in our government, cannot stand us. It puts us on the enemy's radar. And so it is vital to understand that the church at Smyrna was facing the pressure that accompanies being a faithful follower of Jesus Christ. This is just the way it works. Remember what Paul told Timothy. All who desire, let's put it up here, you can see it here. All who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Would you read that out loud with me? All who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus. No surprises here. And yet we're always like, what? What's going on? The New Testament never positions it as a surprise. It always positions it as a. All who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Like, par for the course. No surprises here, no shocker here, right? This is just the way that it is. One commentator said, and I love this, a church cannot be a true church without causing trouble. Isn't that awesome? Without stirring it up, right? Genuine followers of Jesus Christ will make waves, amen? Will make waves and will find themselves in the crosshairs of the devil, the culture, the government, and the ungodly. And here's what Jesus says. Listen, don't fear it. Don't fear it. Expect it. Own it, right? It's just the way that it is. How many of you like this? How many of you, you're loving the message so far? You're like, yeah, this is exactly what I signed up for. You're like, is there anything good here? Yeah. It's gonna get worse before it gets better, but it'll be worth it. Right, that's the message for us, isn't it? Then verse 10 tells us what's up from God's vantage point. Look at verse 10. Behold, the devil's about to throw some of you into prison. And then here it is. That you may be tested. The word Jesus uses for tested means to prove our faith. And it means to improve our faith. To prove it that it's real, that it's legitimate, that it's authentic, to prove it, and then to improve it as we live our Christian lives. And so you need to understand then that persecution proves your citizenship, doesn't it? It reveals that you're with Jesus. And why would followers of Jesus Christ expect a different outcome with their life, for their life, than their Savior? Here's what persecution does. Persecution shows the world that you are aligned with Jesus, because persecution is the great separator in the Christian community, right? It literally weeds out all of the weak sauce people, right? It weeds out all the phonies, all the make-believers, all the pretenders, right? And then you go, all right, here are the ones that are left. And then the ones that are left are the ones that you can count on and trust in, right? Because you know they're all in. Because when they get punched in the teeth, they don't tap out, they don't run home, they don't quit, they don't walk away from their faith. Well, persecution also displays your faith. Listen, here's the illustration, right? You won't know how strong your arms are until you carry something heavy, right? You won't know how strong your legs are until you carry a few burdens on your back. And the point is that we need tested. And if I'm gonna be honest with you, I think this is where we are right now. Culturally, I think that God is testing us. He's testing us. And so as you feel the pressure mounting against the church, against God's word, against your Christian values, as you feel people becoming more and more intolerant of you and hostile towards you and like done with you because of your faith in Jesus Christ, because of your stance on God's truth, know that you are being tested. You are experiencing thalipsis, right? The pressure of a clashing of vision and values between the Christian community and culture, which tells me that Jesus thinks that periodic pressure, periodic testing for the church is a really good thing. It lets us know where we stand. It lets us know how much we need to grow. It lets us figure out what's really significant and important and valuable in life. And so here's what he's doing. You're feeling the clash. You're feeling the pressure. You're being tested in that. Why? He wants us to prove and improve our faith. And so listen, one of the ways that we flourish in our faith when we're feeling this pressure and the squeeze is being put on us is by remembering it's only a temporary test. How many of you find that to be good news? It's just temporary. Well, how do you know it's temporary? Well, the reference to 10 days means it's temporary. It's like this. You go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Temporary. It's limited, right? It means your tribulation, the struggle, the pressure you're feeling has an end date on it. And because you know it's temporary, because you know it's going to be over soon, what do? You stay faithful. You keep enduring. You keep on running. Why? Because it isn't going to go on forever. And by the fact that you know, hey, this is going to be over soon. It's going to be over soon. What does it do? It keeps you engaged. It keeps you grinding. It keeps you gritty in the Christian faith. It helps you to persevere along the way. It keeps your hope alive. A second way we flourish in our faith is by remembering that Jesus promises his people they won't be hurt by the second death. Notice the language, verses 10 and 11. Because when you look at that, you have to understand that we're all going to die a first death, meaning the physical life that we are now currently experiencing has an end date on it. So unless Jesus raptures out God's people, then all of us are going to be planning a funeral someday. We don't know when. God knows when. We don't know when. But we are all going to die a first death, which means, big picture, biblically, theologically, that the real issue, the real death to be concerned about isn't the first one. It's the what? It's the second one. It's the second one. Because the second death is the final death, the eternal expulsion from the presence of God. So I want you to notice, I'm gonna put this on the screen so you can see it. I want you to notice, Jesus does not promise immunity from the first death, but he does promise immunity from the second death, the most important one. And so here's how it works. If you are born physically, and you are, congratulations, you've accomplished that birth, you're here, right? If you've been born once, and you have, way to go, you're here, you did it. But you're not born again spiritually, what does the Bible say? You will die twice. But if you are born physically, and you've done that, and you are born again spiritually from above, you will die once and then be raised to eternal life. So being born once leads to a death once and a second death. Being born physically, and then being born spiritually from above, trusting in Jesus Christ, means that you've been made alive physically and spiritually, and you will only experience one death. Now, I don't want to die, but if you gave me the option to die once or to die twice, I'm picking, how about just die one time? That's exactly what Jesus is saying to us here. And here's what he's doing. Like, I know your trials, I know your tribulation, I know the heartaches you're going through, I know your poverty, I know the government's against you, I know the culture's against you, I know your own countrymen are against you. I get it, I know. And it's gonna get worse before it gets better. It's gonna be worth it, it's gonna be hard, but here's what I want you to understand. You gotta lift your head up. You gotta lift your head up. He's reminding us of the kingdom of heaven. And so you need to understand then that persecution provokes longing. That's the whole point here, right? So he begins talking about the crown of life to come, the second death, and escaping the second death. How do you do that? Why? He's lifting our heads up. He wants us to see the kingdom, right? He's uprooting our hearts from planet Earth and pointing them to the kingdom of God. And that's what persecution does. It provokes and generates a longing. It causes you to look forward, not just to look around and go, this is awful and it's hard. No. Persecution provokes a longing for something beyond this world. And it is a reminder, whenever you go through tribulation, struggles, hardships, trials, being harassed and pressured by the culture around you, by the government around you, whenever you feel all that, even your friends betraying you, whenever you feel all that, that persecution is a reminder that this world is not your home. Like, this is not it. So he keeps doing this. Lift up your head. Lift up your head. Now, I want to share with you this incredible historical event that hopefully we'll draw a lot of strength from. And so in the month of February, in the year 155 AD, there was an 86-year-old pastor bishop named Polycarp, and he was the bishop pastor of the church in Smyrna. And history tells us that he was an ardent follower of Jesus Christ. He was pressured to renounce and reject Jesus Christ, and that he refused to do so. And so enraged, the proconsul sent a messenger into the city of Smyrna to let everyone know, to announce to everyone that Pastor Polycarp, Bishop Polycarp, had committed high treason against Rome by admitting to be a Christian and then refusing to renounce his Christianity. And so a bloodthirsty mob gathered in the arena of the city to witness his execution. And here were his final words. And I want you to hear these words. I'm gonna put them on the screen. Here's what he said in his darkest moment. 86 years I've served the Lord Jesus. He's been faithful to me. How can I be faithless to him and blaspheme the name of my Savior? Put away those nails. You're not going to have to nail me to this in order to burn me at the stake. Put away those nails and let them be. The one who gives me strength to endure the flames will give me strength not to flinch at the stake. You threaten me with a fire that burns for a short time and is quickly quenched. For you do not know the fire that awaits the wicked and the judgment to come and an everlasting punishment. Why are you waiting? Come do what you will to me. Inspiring, isn't it? Like no fear in life, no fear in death. And then he gave up his life for Christ. But there's a part of the story that I didn't tell you. And I hope it will inspire you to live your life with a faithfulness to God that you've never experienced before. History tells us this, that as Polycarp was bound and burned at the stake, that the Lord didn't let the fire touch him. And so you can go back and read about this on Christian History Institute, his whole story, because it tells you that he was martyred by fire and by sword. You're like, well, fire and sword, why would it be fire and sword? Why wouldn't it just be fire? Well, history tells us that the Lord formed an arch over the top of him. And so he stood in the midst of that fire and was protected from being burned at the stake. So as he stood there, it didn't burn him. And so when the Roman guards saw that he was in the fire, but not on fire, they had to jump into the fire and stab him to death, causing many of them to be burned to death in the process. And Polycarp was faithful to God in his life, and he was faithful to God in his death. And he was a witness to the world until the end. And you know, I keep going back, and you read church history, and you go back to the New Testament, and you'll see this. It's really startling to me. That like men and women in the first century actually, think about this, they actually rejoiced that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. Acts 5:41, go back and read about it. Well, why? Well, because persecution produces communion, right? That's what Paul tells us, right? So in the midst of your tribulation, in the midst of your pain, in the midst of your suffering, in the midst of your harassment, right, you get to experience a deep and lasting intimacy and closeness and fellowship with Christ. Like you are suffering in him and for him and with him, and he meets you in that hard place. So can I encourage you with this truth today, church? God knows your tribulations. He knows. God knows exactly what you're going through, and he doesn't want you to live in fear. He wants you to live by faith, because your tribulations are tests, and they are temporary, and they are designed to prove your faith and to improve your faith and to strengthen your faith. And your faithfulness, if you will be faithful, you will be rewarded at the highest level. So you be bold with your Christian life, even if it leads to your death, because God will give you the crown of life, and you will not be hurt by the second death. You let your pain, amen, amen. You let your tribulation, you let your persecution build your faith, not break it down. You let your pain and your heartache and your tribulation and your persecution provoke longing for Christ and for heaven. Use it to your advantage and let it produce a communion, a closeness with Jesus, unlike anything you've ever experienced before. And so, yeah, tribulations are hard. They're hard, but they're temporary. And so bring them to Christ, lean into him right now. And then I think all of us have to like maybe evaluate and assess and answer the question like, is my faith where it needs to be? Is my faith like improving? Like when the fire comes, am I ready? I think that passage, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Do you know what you've signed up for here in following Jesus Christ? So that you're not like knocked off your game whenever hardship happens. You're like, yep, yep, it's what happens. I'm making a dent in the darkness. I'm making an impact with the gospel. I have enemies, but I'm going to receive the crown of life. And it's just temporary because there's a day that is coming. Well, I'll be rewarded for my faith forever. It's interesting, you read about Stephen's martyrdom in the book of Acts. And it's the only time in the New Testament when he was martyred for his faith and following Jesus Christ. It says that Jesus was at the right hand of God the Father. And as he was being martyred, you know what he did? What Jesus did? Stood up. Saw it. So there's a uniqueness when you read church history. There's uniqueness when you read about the men and women in the first century. We can learn from them. We can be emboldened by them. Is our faith robust? Is it being proved? Is it improving along the way? Or is your life marked more by a fear rather than a faithfulness or a boldness? And then I think, right, we learn in this text, like if you have Christ, and I'm just gonna say this to you, if you have Christ, you're rich, even if you got nothing in your retirement account, okay? If you have Christ, you are rich. Why? Because you have an indestructible wealth. And I'm saying you can have all the wealth in the world, and if you don't have Jesus Christ, you have no idea how impoverished you are. Having Jesus makes you wealthy. Not having Jesus, even if you have the whole world and you lose your own soul, shows you your poverty. And that's what he wants us to see here, right? And then how clear it is, if you're born once, you die twice. If you're born twice, then you die once. So I'm gonna give you a moment here today. Some of you here have never trusted in Jesus Christ before. So let's bow our heads, let's pray together. And if you've never asked Christ to come into your life, you're like, this makes sense, man, this is it for me. I'm gonna ask you to pray this prayer. Don't just mouth the words, but you mean them in your heart. And you can ask Christ to come into your life right now. So pray with me. God, I know that I'm a sinner and I have missed it. And I have fallen short of your glory. And I know as things stand right now that I'm on the pathway of being born once and dying twice. And I want off that pathway. I want to be born again. So right here and right now, I turn from my sins. I trust in the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, who loved me and gave himself for me. I want to be born again from above, right here and right now. So would you forgive me? Would you come into my life, fill me and save me so that I can be born again? Born physically, born from above, so I'll die once. And God, we thank you for the truth today that eternal life begins at faith, not death. And so we thank you that when we trust in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone, life everlasting begins. So Lord, for all those today who've prayed and said yes to Jesus Christ, Lord, I pray, Lord, you'd fill them with your spirit, empty them of them, give them a passion for you, a thirst for your word, a thirst for righteousness, a hunger for truth, and give him a boldness to let the whole world know that they align with you, that they're unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Lord, help us today as a church to be encouraged that our tribulations are hard, and yes, we're being harassed, but it's all temporary. So we lean into you right now, and we pray you'd strengthen our arms to be able to carry the heavy loads, strengthen our legs to be able to carry the burden, strengthen our hearts so we can grind and endure in order that we may be faithful until the end. Thank you for this amazing story of Polycarp. Thank you for the men and women in the New Testament, Lord, who counted it an honor, rejoiced that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And we pray even now that our struggle, our persecution, our harassment will produce communion with Christ. And I pray this in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen and amen.
In Matthew 11, Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Now, I don't know about you, but life has not felt easy or light. It's been hard. And when my feelings betray me, I have to remind myself of this truth, that in Christ alone, I find rest. That his plans for me are good. His plans for you are good. He loves you. He is for you. And so we're going to sing that truth together today as we unite as one body with one voice, that what we want above all else is the nearness of Jesus. So would you stand together, church? This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. Come on and sing. This is the air. This is the air. This is my daily bread. It's all I have. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I I'm desperate for you. The sweetest place I know. Cause your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit's like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp to my feet. Jesus, I love you, I love you. Your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit's like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Jesus, I Jesus, we love you. We love you. We are desperate for you. God, restore to us the joy of our salvation and uphold us with a willing spirit so that when we face suffering and trial and temptation, we can say with joy, it is worth it for our Savior. There's no one more lovely, more radiant, or more beautiful than you. We are yours, and you are ours. And we love you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You can just stay standing for just a moment. We're going to continue in worship this morning with our giving. And as always, you can give in three ways: giving stations, online, or in the app. Your giving allows us to continue making disciples of Jesus Christ across the street, around the world, including supporting all of our amazing ministries getting ready to kick off this fall. There's something for everyone here this fall at Grace: men, women, students, kids. couples. We have a place for each of you, and we want to help you get connected into the life and the body of Christ here at Grace through our programming. Now, all of our programming launches the week of September 10th, so you can take a look at everything that we have to offer this fall and register today by heading to our Connect page at grace.church/connect. And if you need prayer today, you can submit a prayer request on the Connect page or the app, or you can head over to the Prayer Resource Center, my right, your left, after the service, and one of our team members would love to pray with you. Speaking of prayer, let's pray. Father, we thank you for today. Thank you for the ability to gather, to sing, to learn, be shaped and molded by your word and by your spirit. We just pray that you will go with us this week. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We'll see you later.